Hello and welcome to Tech Deals, part two of the $1,500 computer build video series. In part one, I talked all about the parts, the price, what they were, and what benefit they provided. In this video, this is all about the why behind the decision-making process. This is the long video. Sit back, grab a cup of coffee or a bottle of water, relax, make yourself comfortable because we're going to be here for a while. I'm going to talk about each of these parts in detail, benefits they provide, alternative choices you might make to let you make your own decisions in customizing your machine. This is the thinking behind the choices. It's easy to stand up here and say, well, here's all the parts I've picked because I think they're the best. Really, why do you think they're the best? That's this video. So if that's what you're interested, you came to the right place. If you just want the short and sweet version of this, click the links in the video description below that will take you back to part one, which is a much shorter video, or to take you forward to part three, which is the build video. The camera will be overhead. You'll be able to see the case. I'm gonna go through this in a detailed step-by-step build so you can actually see this being put together yourself. So the goal of this machine, this $1,500 computer, is to build an amazing gaming computer to play games at 1440p resolution. That's 2560 across by 1440p vertical. Now you certainly could use this machine to game at 1080p, but it's honestly overkill for 1080p gaming. If you're interested in 1080p gaming, I have other builds for that and other recommendations. This is really about 1440p gaming. What about 4K? Not really. It doesn't have the horsepower for 4K. The graphics card is an excellent GTX 1070, but a 1070 is not really a 4K gaming card. It will play some games at 4K, but I would not choose it as my 4K gaming card if that's your goal. So 1440p is what this machine is at. It's also designed to be easy to grow with in the future. We have an excellent case with room to grow. We have an awesome high-end motherboard with plenty of room to grow and a top-of-the-line CPU. The graphics card is easy to change when we want to upgrade to 4K gaming and something faster comes out, but for the moment, the CPU is top-of-the-line for the general consumer chips because it's much harder to change the CPU than it is the graphics card. Now I'm going to go through each of these parts detailed one at a time, but I just want to do the general summary first, which is 1500 is kind of the sweet spot for 1440p gaming. You can go less, you can spend less than this to be sure and still game at 1440p. But this is meant to be a premium option, not the budget 1440p gaming machine, but the premium 1440p. I wouldn't spend much more than this. If you want a game at 1440p, this is kind of top of the mark, top of the line. Anything higher than this, and then you really should be into 4K gaming territory. There will be a budget build using an i5 processor for 1440p gaming for less than this, but there are more compromises in such a system. I don't want to call this a no compromise system because there are a few compromises. Let's just say it's a very few compromise $1,500 build. The first item in our build is the CPU, the Intel i7-7700K, 4-core, 8-thread, 4.5 gigahertz Kaby Lake CPU from Intel, the new 7th generation chip. This just came out about a week ago in January of 2017. This is the CPU I would recommend for a 1440p gaming machine at the $1,500 price point. What are the other options? Why did I choose this? Good question. In short, at $1,500, there should not be an i5 in your computer. At this price point, i5 should not be in the vocabulary. And as far as i7 CPUs go at this level, there's really one, the i7-7700K. Yes, there is a non-K chip, but at this price point, I would just get the K chip. The price difference isn't that great. Would I go with Broadwell E? You can actually fit Broadwell E in this price point if you want to. Now, Broadwell E is the i7-6800K 6-core 12-thread processor. Now, its Turbo Boost clock speed default is 3.6 gigahertz, but it will easily overclock to 4 to 4.2 gigahertz. However, while I used to recommend it for a high-end gaming machine over Skylake, which was the i7-6700K, the faster clock speeds of Kaby Lake have altered that equation a bit. For strictly gaming, you generally don't need more than a 4-core processor. Now that may change in the future. 2 to 3 years from now, you may want to have a 6-core chip. However, today in 2017, you don't need one. The hyper-threading on the i7 is enough in games like Battlefield 1 to give you smoother performance when the game will use more than 4 threads because it's an 8-thread chip. My hope is with liquid cooling to be able to overclock this Kaby Lake CPU to 5 gigahertz. While having more cores is beneficial, having more clock speed is also beneficial. Broadwell E at 4.2 gigahertz versus Kaby Lake at 5 gigahertz for gaming, if gaming's your primary motivation, I believe I would rather have Kaby Lake at 5 gigahertz than Broadwell E at 4.2. There is one other CPU worth discussing, which I don't have at the moment because it hasn't been released, but it's expected to be released in the first quarter of 2017, and that's AMD's Ryzen. AMD's Ryzen is expected to be much better than the previous CPUs. At this point in 2017, if you're thinking about buying AMD and it doesn't say Ryzen in the name, don't. All of their other CPUs are basically obsolete at this point, unless they're just crazy and expensive. But if you're watching a $1,500 build video, you aren't in the market for any of them. I will, as soon as I can get my hands on an AMD Ryzen, I will buy one, I will test it, I will build a machine with it, and of course I will do videos on it. However, we don't know when it's coming out. We don't know what the price is going to be. We don't know how the performance will compare to Kaby Lake. And until we know those things, I cannot give you any advice about whether or not it's worth considering an AMD Ryzen CPU versus the Kaby Lake. So right now in January of 2017, when I'm filming this, if you want to build a $1,500 1440p gaming machine and Ryzen's not out, you have one choice. Kaby Lake i7-7700K. When the new chip comes out from AMD, we'll take another look at it and see where things stand at that time. But if you're watching this months from now and that chip is out, then definitely take a look at it at that point. The CPU choice leads us to our motherboard, which in this case is the ASUS Republic of Gamers Strix Z270-E gaming motherboard. That's a mouthful. $200 buys you an amazing full-featured board. Now, a separate review of this board will be linked in the description below, including close-up and overhead shots to give you lots of detail on this board. But there are other Z270 board options. But before I mention those, let me be clear about something. The Z270 in the product name is the Intel chipset, and all Z270 boards will support the Kaby Lake chip. So MSI, ASRock, Gigabyte all sell Z270 boards. If one of those is less expensive or your preferred brand, certainly there is nothing wrong with any of those choices. Just keep in mind that each company sells multiple Z270 boards. So if you see one that's less expensive, it might be because there's fewer features. For example, ASUS sells more than a half dozen Z270 motherboards. I haven't actually counted how many, but it's a lot. Even within the Republic of Gamers Strix line, they have a $170 board, $180 board, $190 board, and a $200 board. Yes, they sell four different ASUS Republic of Gamers Strix boards, and they sell three more Republic of Gamers boards above this. They sell the Hero, the Formula, and the Maximus. And actually, I think they do a fourth, the Code. Those are all very expensive boards. They don't fit within a $1,500 build. Those are boutique boards for people who do not really have a budget so much as they just want the best. There's nothing wrong with them. They're great boards with awesome features and every last thing is tweaked to the max, but they are not value for the money. They really aren't. This is the top of the line when it comes to getting features, capabilities, performance for a reasonable price. As you go above the $200 price for a motherboard, you start going up much quicker in price than you go up in features. They're great boards. I've got nothing against those boards. It's just they're very expensive. What happens when you go down in price? You start discarding features. Now, maybe they're features you don't care about. You also don't have to buy a Republic of Gamers Strix board, even if you want ASUS. If you want a white and black color theme without the RGB lighting, although actually they all have RGB lighting these days, even the Dash A boards, for $170, they also sell their new, what they call Prime boards. They've introduced Prime branding, P-R-I-M-E, with their non-gaming motherboards. Now, it's the same as their old non-Prime boards from the 100 series chipset. So a Z170-A is now the Prime Z270-A board. Same basic features, same basic board, now called Prime. Yay! It also has a $20 price increase because the old boards used to be $150 and the new boards are $170. What is the difference between a $170 board and a $200 board? A few things. The sound chip on the Republic of Gamers boards is better than the sound chip on the Prime boards. One of the things you do get is a higher quality sound chip. And if you're gaming, that actually is important. Furthermore, Wi-Fi. This board not only has AC Wi-Fi, but it has very good AC Wi-Fi, dual channel, dual connection, 2x2 Wi-Fi. I don't want to get into the technical details of it, but let's just say that a El Cheapo $20 USB Wi-Fi adapter is not going to be the same as the Wi-Fi adapter included in this. If you want Wi-Fi on your motherboard, spend the extra money to buy a board such as this because the included Wi-Fi is better than the cheap USB Wi-Fi adapters. If you're gaming, you want low latency, high speed connections, good responsiveness. You want the good connection. Now, in addition to that, it is fully featured in every other way. This is basically the top of the line when it comes to adding features to boards. It has two M.2 slots for solid state drives. It has multiple USB 3 and 3.1 ports, both type A and type C. It also supports both Crossfire and SLI for your graphics cards, and many, many other features. Now, for a full review of this board, definitely check out the individual unboxing and overview, which has close-up shots of the actual board itself in the description below. Now, there are other boards, and you'll see many boards labeled Pro and Gaming for lower prices. A really good example is ASRock has an excellent Z270 board for $120. Now you might say, wait a minute, that board's $120. Why would I spend $200 on a motherboard? Great question. Because you can't make any assumptions when you go to the bottom of the price for a board. Yes, it's a Z270. Yes, it'll overclock. It does not have coolers, heat sinks installed on all of its voltage regulator modules. It does not have as many power phases as this board does. And it does not even support SLI. It does support Crossfire because adding that doesn't cost anything. But board companies have to pay to make a board SLI certified. You would not be able to buy the $120 board and then put two GTX 1070s and SLI on it. You would on this. And you would on the $150 to $170 boards. Those all support SLI, but the $120 to $130 boards don't. Something to keep in mind. There's a lot of little things removed. That $120 ASRock board has an old Realtek 800 series audio codec on it. That is very old. Now, it works. It will absolutely produce sound. You can absolutely play games on it. But the difference in sound quality between the sound chip on the $120 board and the sound chip on the $200 board is real. It's worth considering that if you're spending $1,500 on a high-end machine, $350 on your CPU, $420 on your graphics card, saving $50 on your motherboard, losing features, losing overclocking ability, losing heat sinks on your voltage regulators, losing power phases, losing Wi-Fi, doesn't actually save you as much as you think because you are losing features when you come down below this board. And that's why for an i7, this is my new go-to board recommendation because I think the better sound chip, the better power phases, the better cooling on the voltage regulators, the excellent Wi-Fi that's included in this are all well worth it. System memory. I've selected Corsair's 16 gigabyte LPX DDR4 3200 megahertz RAM kit for this machine, about $100. There is size to talk about, and then there's speed to talk about. Let's talk about size first, then we'll talk about the speed. For size, I think 16 gigabytes is the sweet spot in the $1,500 build price point. 8 gigabytes, as far as I'm concerned, is out of the question. There is no reason in 2017 to be building a $1,500 computer with only 8 gigabytes of RAM in it. You only save about $50 and you will have lots of limitations on multitasking and even some games with 8 gigs of RAM in 2017. So 8 gigabytes is out, don't even think about it. What about 32 gigs of RAM? That is the next step up over 16. For a gaming computer and a general consumer machine, I think 32 gigabytes is overkill. You can certainly do it, you won't hurt anything. But to go from 16 to 32 adds $100 to the price point. you either have to take something else out of this machine worth $100 in order to fit 32 gigs of RAM in, or you have to break the $1,500 price point and go up to $1,600. Now, if you want to, you can do that because custom machine, build it any way you want. That being said, for gaming, you don't need more than 16. In fact, most games will still play fine at 8, but there are some, Battlefield 1 comes to mind, that fully utilize 8 gigs of RAM and will use more RAM if you have it. Especially if you have an 8 gigabyte graphics card, you should definitely have 16 gigs of RAM. But you don't need more than 16 to play games or web browse, Skype, stream games, etc. Why might you need more than 16 gigs? Content creation. Now, I have several computers that I do content creation on. All of them now have 32 gigs of RAM. I had one older i7 machine that had 16 gigs of RAM. It was an i7-4790K with 16 gigs of RAM. I have since upgraded it to 24. Why 24? I had 8 gigs sitting on the shelf. It was handy. I grabbed it and stuck it in. I was running into out-of-memory errors in Adobe Premiere Pro editing 4K videos for YouTube on that machine. Now, I will ultimately upgrade it to 32. It has 24 because I had the 8 gigabytes literally sitting next to the machine. It was handy. I put it in. I will at some point get it to 32. But any machine that I do 4K content creation on needs 32 gigs of RAM in 2017. So if you plan to edit 4K videos and you plan to use professional software such as Adobe Premiere Pro, then yes, the extra $100 for 32 gigs is worth it. Now, if you edit 1080p video and you use more consumer-oriented software, Adobe Premiere Elements or even Windows Movie Maker or other such programs, then 16 gigabytes would actually be enough. I'm talking about more professional production. I edit 4K videos every day. I absolutely need 32 gigabytes of RAM, but most people don't. 16 gigs is where it's at. Now that size, let's talk about speed. This is overclocked memory. This board absolutely supports overclocked memory, as should all Z270 boards support it. Standard DDR4 speeds today for Kaby Lake is DDR4 2400. So this is overclocked from 2400 to 3200. Is that going to make your games faster? No, not really. Maybe one frame a second. Is that going to make Windows boot faster? No. Is that going to make web browsing and Skype run faster? No, not really. So why are we installing more expensive overclocked RAM? Why not? It's not much more expensive. How much more? $10 to $20. It is about $80 to $90 for DDR4 2400 versus $100 for 3200. $10 to $20 to get an additional 800 megahertz on a RAM speed strikes me as an easy decision. Battlefield 1 is not going to run noticeably faster on 3200 megahertz RAM than it will on 2400. However, for $10 or $20, why not? It just doesn't make any sense to do anything else at this point. Now that's system RAM, that size and that speed. And that takes us to storage. I have selected two different drives for this machine, a solid state drive and a hard drive. I'll talk about them separately. Solid state drive first. I have selected Crucial's MX300 525 gigabyte solid state drive, $130. Price to performance, this is the sweet spot in the industry right now, and this is what I would buy if I was buying an SSD right now for a $1,500 build. There are alternatives, we'll talk about those in a minute, but I believe that right now for what you're paying and for what this drive provides, that's the one to buy. Now that does come in two different form factors. It comes in a 2.5-inch standard drive size and an M.2 drive that will install on one of the M.2 slots on this motherboard. If the price is exactly the same, I would buy the M.2 version. Why? One less cable, one less thing to worry about in the system. Instead of having to run another power cable and another serial ATA cable to a drive that I have to mount in my case, you simply take the memory stick, insert it on the motherboard. Yes, that will be in the build video coming up next. And screw it in with one screw and you're done. There's nothing to mess with. It couldn't be any simpler. Performance. There is zero difference in performance between the M.2 version and the 2.5-inch version of the MX300. And the reason for that is because they're both serial ATA drives. If you have heard that M.2 drives can be faster, That's because they can be, but they have to be what's called NVMe drives. What is that? Samsung's 950 Pro, which has actually now been replaced by the 960 Pro, but I'm showing you this box because I don't have a 960 Pro, and the new 960 Evo are NVMe drives. What does that mean? It's simply a different way of the drives working. It makes them faster. Faster access times, faster transfer rates. So why not buy one? This board does support them. You can absolutely install an NVMe drive such as a 960 Evo or a 960 Pro. And that's because I don't believe the price justifies the performance. Or to put it another way, the performance doesn't justify the price. A Samsung 960 Evo, 500 gigabytes is $250. 525 gigabytes is $130, half the price. Now, is the Samsung 960 Evo faster than the Crucial MX300? Yes, it is. The benchmarks will show you that transfer speed, read and write speed, is 5 times faster on the 960 Evo than it is on the MX300. Random performance is also faster on the 960 Evo. So why in the world am I recommending this drive? Because in normal consumer applications, normal desktop Windows applications, running games, running web browsers, watching videos, you aren't going to notice a big difference between a 960 Evo and an MX300. My $4,000 Ultimate machine has the 950 Pro in it, which is very, very quick. I have to say, it's not that fast in real-world use. Would I buy this again? No. Sorry, Samsung. It's not worth what you're charging for it. Now, I primarily bought it because I have a YouTube channel, but I wouldn't buy it again. It really isn't worth the money. It's fast, but it's not the leap in performance that solid-state drives are over hard drives. Now, that's a difference. That is a night and day difference. But the jump from hard drives to SSDs is not repeated in the jump from serial ATA SSDs to NVMe SSDs. Until the prices get closer, I don't recommend that you spend the extra money. There might be one exception to what I just said. Intel's SSD 6 NVMe M.2 drive. This is a 512 gigabyte drive, and it's less expensive than the 960 Evo. This can be found for less than $200. So why do I not have this in here instead of the MX300? Because it isn't that cheap. And it's also not as fast as the Samsung drives. It's kind of an in-between drive. It's a budget NVMe drive. Now, everything I've mentioned in this video will be linked in the description below to both Amazon and Newegg. Check current prices. They may have changed. If you can find this drive for $150, would I pay $20 more than the MX300 for this? Absolutely. Yes, I would. How much would I pay for a 960 Evo? About $180 would be my limit. About a $50 price premium over the MX300. Anything more than that and you're just paying too much for a relatively small real-world performance difference. Yes, the benchmarks look great, but that doesn't mean the real-world performance is actually that amazing. So, MX300, great drive. Now, what about other solid-state drives? Now, there are many different solid-state drives on the market. If you want the closest competitor to the MX300, that would be the 850 Evo from Samsung. The 850 Evo is the fastest serial ATA solid-state drive in the world. It is faster than the MX300, but not by a ton. Not noticeably. The benchmarks say it's noticeably faster, but the real-world performance difference isn't that large. I have two different machines that have 850 Evos as their boot drive. I have two different machines that have MX300s as their boot drive. Can I tell the difference? Not really. Kinda, if I'm looking for it. Not really. It's minor. It's there. It's not worth paying a lot extra for. $150 would be fair for an 850 Evo, but that would be the most I'd pay for a 500 gigabyte 850. Yes, I know I'm holding a 1 terabyte. It's what I had handy. A 500 gigabyte 850 Evo for $150 or an MX300 for $130 is where I'd be at. So putting aside Crucial and Samsung for a minute, what about other SSD drive companies? There are many companies that are selling SSDs today. ADATA, PNY, Kingston. There are many good drives from these companies. SanDisk, Western Digital even has solid state drives now. Price comes into play here. If you can find a 500 gigabyte solid state drive for around the $100 to $110 price point, and it's from a company such as PNY, ADATA, Kingston, and so on, yes, they're all worth considering. Most of those drives do tend to be a little bit slower than the MX300 or the Samsung drives. However, will you really notice it on a day-to-day basis? Probably not. They will all be miles ahead of a hard drive. However, I would still make the argument that if you're spending $1,500 on your computer, another $20 for your solid-state drive to get a Crucial or a Samsung makes sense. So in this machine, even though I have multiple SSDs, I'm still going to be using the good ones. That leads us to hard drives. For this machine, I have selected a 2 terabyte Seagate 7200 RPM Barracuda hard drive for $70. It's a great value for the money, a lot of space. 2 terabytes of solid state drive space would run you more than $400. That would be very expensive. $70 is much more reasonable. But I selected this drive also for its speed. It is a 7200 RPM drive versus a 54 or 5900 RPM drive. When it comes to hard drives, it's worth noting that there's two basic types. You have your low power, efficient, economical drives designed for long-term data storage. The Western Digital Green Series is a good example. The Seagate Archive drives are a good example of drives that are not meant to run programs. They're meant for you to copy things like video files to and then basically leave them alone. The Barracuda line of drives from Seagate or the Blue line from Western Digital are performance drives designed for everyday use of running programs. Do you want to play games such as Battlefield 1, Grand Theft Auto 5, Call of Duty Infinite Warfare? Call of Duty Infinite Warfare is more than 80 gigabytes in size. You will use up your precious solid-state drive space very quickly installing games such as that, and they do in fact run pretty well from a hard drive. That being said, if you already own a hard drive or need a different size, certainly you can choose something else. I will link in the video description below to both Amazon and Newegg to the 2 terabyte drive. When you go to the product detail page, directly beneath the price on Amazon or right in the center of the page on Newegg, is going to be a size selector. And then you can choose the 1 terabyte or 3 or 4 terabyte drive size. Look at the prices and compare the size to the price. If it's only $10 more for a 3 terabyte drive, then by all means, take the 3 terabyte drive. If the 1 terabyte drive suits your need, then certainly choose that. I'm not going to link to every size. It would make it too long. I will also link to the Western Digital 2 terabyte blue drive, which is very similar to the Barracuda. Great everyday performance. Again, to both Amazon and Newegg, check the prices of the sizes above and below it because you might find a bargain for just an extra $10 or $20. You might get double the space. Sometimes they're really good deals. And that brings us to our video card. Many different video card choices on the market. I have selected the ASUS Republic of Gamer Strix NVIDIA GeForce GTX 1070 8GB factory overclocked graphics card. Yes, that's a mouthful, but it's a really nice graphics card for about $420. Now, you can really choose any GTX 1070 that you want, but this is a very nice one because it includes ASUS's Aurora RGB 16.7 million color lighting. So does the Strix gaming motherboard. In fact, the Aurora software that comes with these cards will link them together if you are interested. So if you want your colors to strobe or pulse or breathe, there's many different features. You can have the colors change based on the temperature of the system, the load of the system, or simply a pulsing, and you can have a color cycle running. It will link the two cards, the motherboard and the graphics card together, so they match. That's a nice feature. Now, if you don't care about RGB lighting, you can turn it off on both the board and the graphics card. But if you want, there's a nice side window in this case. So if you want beautiful lighting, I would actually recommend that you get a card that works with the motherboard so it all syncs up. It makes your life much easier. Now, I've done a separate review of this card, and a link to that review will be in the description below. If you want to know more about the specific card, go check that out, because I'm not going to talk about that here. Instead, I'm going to talk about performance briefly. Let's talk about upmarket for a second. why for $1,500 do we have a GTX 1070 versus a 1080, which is the card above this right now? Price. This card is about $400. The GTX 1080 is about $600 and change. For $600, you're spending 50% more money, or about $200 more, but you're only getting 20 to 30% more performance. Now, if you want to game at 4K, I highly recommend that you get a GTX 1080, but now we're not keeping to our $1,500 price point. Now you're at $1,700. If you're okay with that, again, custom machine, build it any way that you want. But in terms of performance for the dollar, as you go up in terms of graphics cards, you get less and less performance for each additional dollar that you spend. So 50% more money, say an average of 25% more performance, it's not as much of a deal. Now, it's true that the same argument works the other direction. Below the GTX 1070, you have the RX 480 from AMD, and you have the GTX 1060 from NVIDIA. Both of those start at about $200. They are not half the performance of this card. This card, depending upon the game, is between 50 to 70% faster than the RX 480 and GTX 1060. So you are paying a premium for the performance, but if you want to build a $1,500 machine and you want to game at 1440p, you really need a GTX 1070. The RX 480 and the GTX 1060 are great 1080p gaming graphics cards. They will run some games at 1440p. Certainly either card will run Overwatch at 1440p just fine. Will they run The Division at 1440p? Yeah, at lower detail settings they will, but they are performance limited on those types of games. This card is not. The GTX 1070 in general will run all current games at 1440p resolution, at 60 frames per second average performance, at an average of high detail. Some games will run at ultra, some have to be at high, and as we move through 2017, there will be some games that might need medium in order to maintain 60 frames per second. Now, if you want to remove that restriction and simply have all games play at either high or ultra detail at 1440p, well, then you do need to spend the extra $200 to get the GTX 1080. You'll need that extra performance to get that guarantee of ultra detail, at least for 2017. But keep in mind that guarantee is not going to hold for all that long. Get into 2018 and it's going to go away. If you want to maintain high resolution, ultra detail, you basically have to replace your graphics card every year. Replacing your graphics card every year can get a bit expensive. Some people do it. Most people, I believe, replace their graphics card every 3 to 4 years or so. This card will provide 1440p gaming for 3 years. I'm very comfortable with that. What it won't do is maintain high to ultra detail for 3 years. As the years progress to 2018 and 2019, you're going to have to slowly start working the graphics detail down from ultra and high to medium, and then medium to low. Now, this is another point very important to make. Medium detail in 2019 will probably look just as nice as ultra detail does in 2017. After all, medium detail or even low detail today looks much better than low detail from 5 years ago. Run Battlefield 1 in low detail. Compare it to screenshots of Battlefield 2 in ultra. I promise you, Battlefield 1, which ironically, Battlefield 1 sounds like it came before Battlefield 2, it didn't. But run the older Battlefield games in ultra and compare them to the new one in low. Low detail today is much better than ultra detail from just a few years ago. So the fact that you'll have to turn the detail sliders down is not as bad as it sounds, because games will continue to get more and more detailed, and by turning the detail settings down, what you're actually doing over time is maintaining a given level of pretty, a given level of attractiveness in terms of how the game looks. It's just that more becomes possible over time, and to keep that scale rising, you would need more and more powerful graphics cards. Now, speaking of more powerful graphics cards, there are two options expected to come out sometime in 2017. They are not out yet, one of which is Vega from AMD. It's the card above the RX 480, and it's expected to compete with the 1070 and the 1080. We do not have, when I'm filming this video in January of 2017, we do not have pricing or availability or any knowledge of its performance right now. So I cannot give you any advice about upcoming Vega. We don't even know what the cards will actually be called at retail. Will they be Vega? Will they be RX 490s? We just don't know. If you are watching this video in, say, the summer of 2017 and they are out, then whatever advice I'm giving you today is going to have to be modified based upon new products at the time. I'm simply mentioning it here because somebody is bound to say, especially a couple months from now, why didn't you talk about Vega? This was filmed in January of 2017. It didn't exist at the time, or at least it wasn't out at the time. Now, I know that is a lot of ifs or maybes based upon rumors and products that are not yet released, or we don't even know prices and performance yet. However, I know that Kaby Lake is going to be stable for a year. It just came out this week. I've had this 2 days and I got it on release day. This is not changing for 2017. This might. And so I'm putting this in here because if you're watching this later in 2017, I just want you to look at the graphics cards as they then exist. Almost everything else in this build is going to be static. The RAM's not going to change that much. The SSDs won't change. The coolers aren't going to change. The case isn't going to change. It's the graphics card that you want to take the closest look at. That's what the comment section is there for. By all means, post a comment or look at my newer videos. I may do an update to this video later in the year. If new graphics cards come out, we'll just have to wait and see. One final point to make about this card. If you decide to build this machine when this card is what makes sense to buy, something to keep in mind is that if you want more performance, either this year, next year, or at some point in the future, you always have the option to buy a second card and put them into SLI or Scalable Link Interface. The nice thing about SLI is it lets you buy one card now and buy another card in the future. You will get between 50 to 70% performance scaling with two cards. It's never one-to-one. You don't double your performance, but it does provide you the ability to actually have a faster solution than a GTX 1080 by having two 1070s. But it's worth noting that not every game supports SLI. In some games, you simply will not get any performance benefit. In others, you'll get a lot. Grand Theft Auto V scales very well with SLI. Rise of the Tomb Raider does not scale at all. So you're just going to be hit and miss with what scales. I personally believe that buying the fastest possible graphics card makes more sense than putting two mid-level cards together. But one option with this card is you can buy one now, and in a year, when you want some more performance, and hopefully these are discounted and cost less, you can pick one up for less money and add it to your existing system. Power supply. We need power for our computer. How much to buy, what type, what efficiency rating. There are many, many different power supplies on the market. I have chosen EVGA's Supernova 850-watt B2 semi-modular power supply. They're about $80 or so. Very nice. It will easily run this processor overclocked as high as you can get it. Plus, it will easily run two graphics cards in SLI or Crossfire together. Semi-modular means that most of the cables in the back are removable. The only cable that's not removable is the main 24-pin ATX motherboard cable. Well, you have to have that plugged in. It plugs into the motherboard. So, the fact that it's semi-modular rather than fully modular doesn't bother me since you will always use that cord. Everything else could be disconnected. So you only need to plug in the specific cables that you need for the hard drives or SSDs or video cards, and then the rest you can keep so it keeps you with an uncluttered system and easier cable management. Do you need 850 watts for everything that you see here? No, not at all. You could easily spend $30 less and buy the 600 watt B power supply from EVGA, or $20 less and get the 650 watt B2 from EVGA. Both good power supplies, both of which I have reviewed. Why would I recommend the 850? Because it's only $20 to $30 more expensive and it gives you the margin for the future. Do you want to add a second graphics card? Do you want to add more hard drives? Do you want to expand your system? Maybe in 2 or 3 years, you want to upgrade your processor. You want to go to something that uses more power. This case and that power supply should last you 10 years. You should easily go through 2 or 3 full computer upgrades without having to change your power supply or your case. So go ahead and buy that extra power supply now, and then you never have to worry about it. If you buy the 600 watt power supply, you'll save yourself $30 today. But if in the future you go, well, boy, I really need another 200 watts because I'm adding extra video cards or I'm upgrading my CPU, then you have to change the whole power supply. And changing a power supply can be a bit of a pain because it connects to everything. You have to disconnect it. You have to go buy another one. I personally feel at the $1,500 price point, a 750 to 850 watt power supply is where you should be at. And that is really well priced at about $80 for an 850 watt semi-modular 80 plus bronze power supply. That's a deal. Now, a couple things to talk about is efficiency ratings and brands. Now, I've reviewed both Corsair and EVGA power supplies on my channel. They're not the only makers of power supplies in the world. Seasonic is also a good brand. In fact, that probably was made by Seasonic, simply branded by EVGA. To the best of my knowledge, EVGA doesn't actually make power supplies. I believe Seasonic and one other company actually provides the guts of their power supply as a white label, and then they brand them. But what you get from EVGA is excellent US-based customer service. I've used EVGA support on other products before. When you call them, you will reach somebody local. You'll reach somebody who can help you. They have offer advanced exchange warranty service. If you have a problem with your power supply, they will send you out a replacement before they get the one back. Great company. I like buying their products. Very, very good. But if you prefer Seasonic or wherever you live, maybe they're cheaper, Seasonic is also fine. Corsair makes great power supplies. I love their power supplies. They tend to be a little bit expensive. They do cost more than EVGA's units. However, if you find a good deal on a Corsair power supply, by all means buy it. I own several Corsairs and they are wonderful. So in terms of brand, Corsair, EVGA, and Seasonic would be the three brands that I personally would go with. There are others, but those are the ones that I have personal experience with and so I can recommend. Power efficiency. I mentioned it's an 80 plus bronze. What does that mean? What should you buy? When it comes to the power efficiency of power supplies, there are many different choices. The straight 80 plus are known as the white power supplies. Those are 80% or more power efficient. 80 plus bronze is 85%, and then it goes to silver, gold, platinum, and titanium. For a $1,500 machine, I don't think a gold power supply is necessary. If you spend a lot of money on electricity, if where you live, power costs a lot of money, it might make sense to buy a gold power supply. They will cost you a little bit more money, but you will get more efficient power consumption. Now, what does that mean? What that means is, let's say, to use an even number for simple math, let's say that your computer is going to pull all 850 watts that power supply provides because you have multiple graphics cards and everything running maxed out. You need all 850 watts. That power supply will provide 850 watts of power to the components in your machine. But in doing so, it's going to draw 1,000 watts from the wall, losing 15% approximately in the conversion from the power from the wall to the 12, 5, and 3.3 volts necessary in your computer. Now, a gold power supply might only draw 950 watts from the wall to provide 850 watts of power instead of 1,000. It might save you 50 watts, which is basically a light bulb. In and of itself, that's not a lot of electricity, unless you use your computer all day every day and you pay a lot for power. If it's only $10 more for a gold power supply of a similar rating, sure, why not? Help the planet, help your utility bills, it's great. But sometimes the gold power supplies can be $30, $40, or more dollars over the price of the bronze. Over 3 to 5 years of operating that power supply, you aren't going to save enough money from your utility bill to justify the extra cost of the power supply. So it's sort of a personal choice. How much do you want to save a little bit of electricity, and how much more does the power supply cost? That's what those efficiency ratings mean. Computer case, we need something to put our computer parts into. I have chosen Corsair's Carbide Spec 01 Mid-Tower computer case. This is an excellent computer case, and for $50, it's an amazing choice. Why? It is a mid-tower instead of a mini-tower. There is room for two graphics cards, multiple drives, lots of features inside this. there's a place for 5 fans. It includes 1 intake fan, and then you're going to use your liquid cooler as the exhaust fan. Now that may be enough depending upon if you add to this machine or not. With 1 graphics card, that's probably enough. It is vented on the top, so there will be passive cooling out the top, but you can add additional fans in the front and the top if you wish. If you want to add a fan to the top, I would add 1 more intake fan to the front to balance it out. 2 intake for 2 exhaust makes for a balanced system. Now, the actual 120mm fans that I would put in here are the AF120 airflow fans from Corsair. AF, not SP. What's the difference? Static pressure versus airflow. And this is something that really deserves its own video. But if you look at the fans, and I will link to them in the video description below to Amazon and Newegg, but AF fans are for case fans, they're for airflow. SP fans are for things like liquid coolers, static pressure. The fans in the liquid coolers are SP fans because they've got to put pressure against the radiator vanes to push air through them in order to cool them. So make sure that you buy for the case AF fans. Important point. Now, you can get them in LED lit and non-LED lit. Those are certainly your choices. There's a lot of options to pick from. When you click the link in the video description below, they will take you to a page that will have 1 of those colors. And if you look below the price on Amazon or in the center of the page on Newegg, you'll be able to click, do you want a blue fan or a red fan or a white fan? You can choose the different LED colors if you're interested. The other thing I like about that case is that it is powder coated inside and out. There's no raw sharp metal edges. If you buy a really cheap case to put your nice computer parts in, you'll actually find inside it's not always finished very well. You can cut your hands, it's just bare metal everywhere. This case is beautiful inside and out. It has a large window on it to show off all your beautiful components, especially your RGB lighting on these 2. It also has USB 3 ports on the front, and it has the power supply mounted where it belongs, which is down on the bottom, to keep the heat from your processor and from your graphics card away from the power supply. That also helps it run more efficiently. Now, while I like this case for the value it represents, $50 for a mid-tower case with lots of expansion options, not everybody wants that specific case. There are so many personal choices. A case is often a very personal choice. There are tempered glass see-through cases, there are full tower cases, there are small ITX cases, there are square cases. There is no way I can cover all those available choices. What I will say is that with high-level components such as this, don't go cheap on your computer case. This is about the least expensive computer case that I would buy, and it's a deal at that price. This would be a fair price. This would be a fair case at $70. At $50, it's just a crazy bargain. If you want a larger case, my personal favorite, which I have reviewed and I have built a machine in, is the Corsair Obsidian 750D full tower case. It goes on sale from time to time. It's usually priced in the $130 range, which is expensive, but for what it is, it's worth every penny. I built my $4,000 machine in it, and it's just wonderful. There is a smaller version for about $100 called the 450D. Same case, slightly shorter. It's a mid-tower instead of a full-tower case. Check that out if you are interested. One final point regarding the Spec 01. Corsair also makes a Spec 02 and a Spec 03. Almost the same case, the difference is the internal configuration. Drive cages and such, it's different inside. I picked the Spec 01 because there are 4 toolless drive bays in the bottom front that make it easy to install a hard drive or an SSD easily. The others are configured a bit differently. All I can suggest is that you take a look at the internal pictures of each of the specs if you're interested in seeing what the difference between 1, 2, and 3 is. That's beyond the scope of this video to talk about it, but I would encourage you to look at the differences if you want a slightly different configuration, but otherwise you like the price and overall appearance of the case. Beyond that, further case reviews will have to be in other videos. And last but not least, we come to our liquid cooler for our CPU. Why liquid cooling? There's a couple of reasons why, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But I chose the Corsair H80i V2 120mm thick liquid cooler. This actually has the cooling performance of a 240mm liquid cooler in the space of a 120. What they did was they made it twice as thick and put 2 fans on it, 1 on either side. That will fit very well in the Spec 01 case. In fact, if you look at the product shots on Corsair's website, that's what they have installed in that case in the back as an exhaust fan, so it will work perfectly. This cooler for $90 provides all the cooling performance that you need to overclock your new Kaby Lake i7 CPU to 5 GHz and possibly beyond. Now, there are many different cooling options on the market, but for this case and this price point, I actually think this is probably the option that most people should consider. It fits very well in mid-tower cases. If by chance you have a full tower case or a case that has more fan mounts or more room, you could absolutely consider the 240 or 280 millimeter versions of Corsair's liquid cooler. The 280 millimeter version, which I installed on my $4,000 build, is this one, the H115i. It has almost the exact same cooling power, maybe a little more because it's 280 instead of 240, as the H80, but it does cost a bit more. How much? About $20 to $25 more. So if you have a case that will take a 280 millimeter cooler, you might want to go with the H115i. If, on the other hand, you want a 240 millimeter liquid cooler, I would go with Corsair's H100i V2 liquid cooler. This has basically the same cooling performance as the H80, but instead it has two fans, but it's spread out side by side rather than being front to back. Very similar price, about $100, so it's about $10 more expensive than the H80. That's a very minor difference. Buy the one that works for the case that you're choosing to buy. Either way, I own multiple copies of these. In fact, this isn't even in here. This has been installed in something. The H100 is waiting for a build, and that H115i is in my $4,000 system. I also own a couple of H90s and an H60 as well. I really like Corsair's liquid coolers. Knock on wood, I've been using Corsair liquid coolers for 3 years now. I have not had any problems. They've worked very well, and I know that Corsair will stand behind them if I do have a problem. They're very good with support. Air cooling. Is air cooling an option? Yes, it is. What would I choose? That's a good question. If you're looking for an air cooler because you wish to spend less money than this, then I would recommend the Hyper 212 Evo from Cooler Master. It's about $30, and for $30 you get an excellent air cooler. It does not have the same level of thermal cooling performance as this does, but it also costs a lot less. It's $30 instead of $90. Does that make a big difference when we're talking about a $1,500 build? That's a personal choice, and I can understand why some people would choose to go with an air cooler that costs less because they're trying to save money. You could use that $60 to get a larger hard drive or to get more SSD or to buy a faster video card or to buy a nicer case. You could certainly upgrade your case if you downgraded your cooling. That's a personal choice. Would I spend more than $30 on an air cooler? I really wouldn't. There are very nice air coolers that cost more than $30. In fact, there is one air cooler, the DH15, which costs $90, the same as this. It also provides almost the same level of cooling performance as the H80i. Some people would argue it provides more. I would argue it actually provides a bit less. Here's why. I am fully aware that in open test bench tests, the DH15, which is a $90 air cooler, and it's massive. It is absolutely monstrously large and well-made. Everything I've read about it says that it is absolutely cream of the crop in terms of air coolers. First, it's not going to fit into the Spec 01 case. You'll need a larger case. It really is massive. Second, it does tend to block RAM slots and other objects in your machine because it is so big. Third, you run the risk of breaking your motherboard because it's so big if you move your computer and you set it down harder than normal by mistake, it may break loose from the motherboard, destroying it. That would be bad. Finally, cooling performance. I know I said that, I segued. Cooling performance. If you take this motherboard and set it out here in the open in this air-conditioned room, and you put the DH15 on the CPU and overclock it, and then you take this liquid cooler in this room and put it on the CPU and overclock it, you will get about the same cooling performance, about the same temperature drop. They will do very, very well. How many of you plan to do that and actually have your computer sitting out with no case. Probably none of you, or very, very few of you. When you put all these parts into a case and then you put the side panel on it, something changes. The heat from the DH15 stays in your case and it has to be exhausted by additional fans. So now you have fans on the air cooler itself, and now you need additional exhaust fans, and I would recommend at least two exhaust fans if you go with an air cooler such as that. Furthermore, what sits directly above your graphics card? Your CPU. As all the heat comes off of your graphics card when you're gaming, all that heat, because heat rises, this is an open air cooler, that heat goes straight into the air cooler on your CPU. This doesn't happen in open air tests. The only way to properly test it is in a closed case, and I see very few hardware reviewers testing in closed cases because it takes much more time to mount everything in a case, close it up, and actually do tests that way. Now, some people do, but most don't, sad to say. So the heat from the graphics card hits the cooler. That doesn't happen with a liquid cooler because the heat is taken directly off of the CPU die using the liquid pump, and it's transferred via the tubes to the radiator, which is mounted in the back of the case, and the fans directly expel the heat out of the back of the system. The heat from your graphics card does not affect the temperature of the radiator of the liquid cooler nearly as much as it does an air cooler. And I believe that in real-world applications, the Corsair H80, H100, and H115 will outperform a DH15 by a bit. Not tons, we're not talking 50% or 100%, but by a bit, because of the way the airflow works in a closed case. Finally, appearance. That cooler is so big, it will dominate your machine. With the big open window of a case, all you're gonna be looking at is this big chunk of metal. The liquid cooler is just this nice little block, and it leaves a nice big airflow, a big space inside your machine for good airflow. I do believe it increases overall case cooling as well. I personally will not build another high-end machine without liquid cooling. Liquid cooling has arrived to the point to where anybody can install this. There's nothing to refill, and this is a point worth making. You don't have to fill this up. It's sealed. You never top it off. You never adjust it. You never check it. You never do anything. It's good to go. You take it out of the box. You plug it in. You use it. And you don't ever have to think about it again. It's really become very simple and very easy to use. The last comment that I'll make is, what about open loop cooling? Custom loop cooling, another way to put it. That is way beyond the scope of videos that I do or my own personal experience. If you really want to see some amazing, cool, open-loop coolers, there are other tech channels which do a really good job of it, and I would never even dream of competing with them. Jay's Two Cents loves open-loop cooling, for example, and he's done some really beautiful builds, gorgeous builds that are works of art. So I would send you to look at his liquid cooling if you're interested in doing custom open-loop cooling. It's just way beyond the scope of a channel called Tech Deals, because you're gonna spend time and money that does not necessarily provide you with performance. It provides you with a build experience and an ability to customize your system and make it look the way you want. That is a very, very different thing, and it's beyond what I'm going to be doing here. If you're interested in such things, check out Jay's Two Cents videos on custom loop cooling, because he has done some beautiful, beautiful builds. So that's a detailed look at each of these individual parts, different choices you can make, and why I picked what I picked. With a custom machine, you can build it any way you want. So certainly, if you want an MSI motherboard or an EVGA graphics card or a Thermaltake case, by all means, it's your system. Build it any way you want. This is a suggested balanced build designed to put similar level parts together. Quality high-end parts such as this ASUS Republic of Gamers motherboard, a quality liquid cooler, quality solid-state drives, quality cases. Everything goes together really, really nicely. I don't like using really high-end parts in one part of a computer and then going really cheap in other parts of the machine. That's why everything here is quality name brand, Corsair memory, Seagate hard drives, EVGA power supplies, and so on. There is one other thing I want you to consider. If you've watched this part of the video, awesome. If you've watched all of this and this all seems like a lot to think about, and then you watch the next coming video, which will be the build video, and you decide you don't want to build a machine or you want to know about another option, let me present you one. buy a computer. Yes, even after all of this, you still might want to consider buying a machine rather than building your own. Now, there's a lot to be said for building your own. After all, you can customize it, pick out the exact parts you want, make it look exactly the way you want, make sure that you have premium everything. There's value in that. There's also value in building your own in learning more about how machines work. If you've never built one before and you've always wanted to try it, now's the time. It's not that hard. It's just basically inserting parts together. It's intimidating the first time. But if you watch my build video, it will be step by step. It'll be very long because it's designed to allow you to buy all these parts, sit down, watch the video, and actually put it together even if you've never built a machine before. But if you just decide it's not worth the trouble, then there will be two links in the video description below. One is to Amazon and one is to Newegg. They are to a $1,500 CyberPower PC that's almost exactly this machine. CyberPower PC is a boutique computer builder. It is different than Dell, HP, Lenovo, Asus, and Acer. Asus, Dell, Lenovo, Acer, HP are large tier one OEMs. They make custom machines. They use a lot of non-standard parts. You can't always upgrade those machines very easily. CyberPower is similar to Falcon Northwest, Origin PC, iBuyPower, all of which are fine. I just have recent experience with CyberPower. They build computers out of off-the-shelf parts. All the parts you see here, they can put into a computer for you. The deals they offer, however, are on Amazon and Newegg. Now, you can go to cyberpowerpc.com and custom configure a machine using basically all of these parts, but they do charge more for it because they build those as one-offs. The machines on Amazon and Newegg are less expensive. For $1,500, i7-7700K, 16 gigs of RAM, solid-state drive, 2 terabyte 7200 RPM hard drive, GTX 1070, liquid cooling, mid-tower case. Basically the same specifications for the same money, but you get a bonus. That computer comes assembled and ready to run. It comes with a copy of Windows 10, which this $1,500 price doesn't include. It comes with a copy of Windows 10. It comes with a keyboard and mouse. It comes with a 1-year parts and labor warranty from one company. If you have a problem, you don't have to figure out what the problem is. It's their problem, not yours. Let them solve it. Furthermore, if you buy it from Amazon and it arrives and you take it out of the box, put it on your desk or under your desk, plug your monitor in, plug your keyboard and mouse in, turn it on, and for whatever reason you have a problem with it, either it doesn't turn on or it crashes or you have some other problem with it, Amazon will ship you a replacement. You can send that one back. You don't have to worry about it. If you buy all of these parts off of Amazon and Newegg and you take them out of the boxes and you assemble everything in there and you turn it on and it doesn't work, now what? Return everything? Oh boy. Or return one thing. What's wrong? If you don't have a lot of spare parts, if you're not used to diagnosing problems with PCs, if you take all these parts, put them in the machine and turn it on and it works, you're great. What if it doesn't? Then you have a challenge on your hand. If you buy a pre-built machine, you don't, because it's not your problem. Let it be Amazon or Newegg's problem if it's within 30 days, or CyberPower PC's problem if it's beyond that. Something to consider, I know that not everybody who watches these types of videos wants to buy a pre-built. However, if you've been watching my channel for a while, you have seen the 50 videos that I did, and that's not an exaggeration, look at the playlist, on the $720 CyberPower PC. That computer is an amazing deal. I still have it, I kept it. And it's not cheap junk. That has an MSI motherboard and MSI graphics card. It has a Cooler Master MasterBox 5 case, 600 watt power supply. It's a well-built machine for $720. I like it so much I kept it, and if I needed another gaming machine at that price, I'd buy another one. It's that good. And no, CyberPower is not paying me to say that. They don't even know I've made these videos. If they ever want to send me a machine for review, I would do so, but I would put a disclaimer in the videos up front letting you know. But no, they did not send that. They're not sponsoring this in any way. I just like the machine. It really is that good. But keep in mind that if you buy a machine, you cannot control the brand of the power supply. You don't control the brand of the RAM or the motherboard. If that's important to you when custom building a machine, then build your own. If you don't care about whether the graphics card is an ASUS or an MSI or an EVGA, then buy a pre-built and save yourself a few hours of build. Save yourself the worries and troubles of having to figure out what's wrong with it if it doesn't work. And just buy basically this machine out of the box, because it is this machine. You just don't get to control which specific parts you end up with, but you do get at least this level of performance. Like this video if you like it. Share it with your friends if you loved it. Remember to subscribe to my channel with the big button below this video. Questions and comments in the comment section below. And as always, check out my video description. It's going to be quite long. There's a lot of links down there. Links to my individual video reviews for all of these products will be down there. Links to Amazon and Newegg for all of these items and everything I talked about in this video is going to be down there. And the link to the $1,500 CyberPower PC pre-built at both Amazon and Newegg will be down in the video description below, which is basically this machine but put together for you. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you in the next video.